So, again, fast forwarding, Goethe's family put out some more papers that had never been made public before, and they needed someone to edit the scientific ones. Goethe was a great scientist. Nobody ever pays attention to that. So there weren't a lot of Goethe science scholars. So, but there was Rudolf Steiner. So they invited him to come to Germany, to Weimar, to work at the archive and go through all those papers. He did it. It was terrible, very disappointing to him, very pedantic, their whole approach. Anyway, during that time, he got his PhD. In Austria, you couldn't get a PhD if you went to the Realschule and the technical college track. But in Germany, they didn't mind. So he could actually do his PhD and got it in Germany. He wrote a book called The Philosophy of Freedom. So that was kind of the culmination of that task that he saw for himself when he was a teenager. We're hoping I'm not going to. I'd love to tell you the philosophy of freedom in a few sentences, but I won't. Basically, the question is, is there such a thing as free will? That was the question. And the answer is yes, if you find the region of the soul where you can be free. Yeah? So we're not just like given freedom. I'm not free if I just grab something that I want. I have to find the part of my soul which is free, and I can be free. Okay? So it's a path. It's a hard book on first read, but he did it on purpose so that you would actually find your way to the region of the soul where you can be free. That's why he wrote the way he did. People often say, oh God, Rudolf Steiner's work is so hard to read. He did it on purpose. So that you would have to struggle. And by doing that, you're building up your capacity to think. And when you get the idea from a few sentences, it's like, eureka, I got it. It's so alive, it's so meaningful. I mean, it's just like, whoa. And it's worth the effort. He wrote a book on Nietzsche. He actually met Nietzsche after he had gone kind of mad. Anyway, and he wrote my favorite book. There's another book. I'm just going to say it in case you're ever looking at books by Rudolf Steiner. There's a book called Goethe's Worldview. Mm-hmm. It's a great book. It's like a condensed version of the philosophy of freedom, but it gives you the history of Western thought. So, it's brilliant. Okay, when he finished the archive, he was now ready to... Yes.
I just wanted to know with his PhD, what did he get? What did he
philosophy. Yeah. He moved to Berlin and took over editorship of a literary magazine, and that didn't really make a living for him. Luckily, before he starved to death, he was discovered as a lecturer. And he became very much sought after as a lecturer in Berlin. And one of his favorite things, which he did for, I think, almost 6 years, was to teach at the Socialist Workers' College. He said, they asked him, and he said, are you kidding? I don't believe in socialism. But he said, I'll teach if you want, but I won't teach your doctrine. And he said yes. And he turned that college into something very much popular. I mean, they started off giving him classes in a small room, and before you know it, they needed to hire spaces for 200 students. He became the most popular teacher. There's so many stories I'm not telling. Anyway, the board of the college said, we want to give you more money because you're drawing so many more students to the college. He said, no. Give all the teachers a raise.
Not
so
bad.
He was already putting his social ideals into practice in that time. somebody heard one of his lectures and recommended that when Nietzsche died, that the Theosophical Society, which also had its branch in Berlin, might want to invite Rudolf Steiner to speak on Nietzsche because he had written a book on Nietzsche when he was at the archive. So he went and he spoke there on Nietzsche, and they really liked it. So he was invited back for the next week. And they said, you can talk on anything you want to talk about. So he talked about Goethe's fairy tale, The Green Snake and the Beautiful Lily. It's a beautiful story. Anyway, that was what he talked about. They liked it so much, they said, come back every week. So the next week, he started a series of 27 lectures, and he just went on and on at the Theosophical Society, but with the same proviso, I don't go for your literature, your whole thing. I'm not into Eastern occultism, but if you want me, I'll teach. So they said, come. So that was a big new thing for him, because finally he was able to find an audience that was really open to what he had to say. He made it very clear that his was a Christian path and also based on thinking, because a lot of the theosophical thing was, you know, don't think. And that was not at all what he was about. Many of the books that we have by Rudolf Steiner now began as lectures from this time. One is a book called Knowledge of the Higher Worlds, where he says that people who have, you don't just have the gift of clairvoyance. I mean, he did from childhood, but he said, actually, those capacities slumber in all of us. And you can cultivate those capacities by certain exercises and certain attitudes. And he then, there's the book Theosophy, which describes the constitution of the human being, body, soul, and spirit, which I won't try to explain right now. But another way of looking at the human being is that we have a physical body, but we're also alive. I'm going to have the same physical body when I die. It'll be a corpse, but it'll still be the same physical body. But now, it's alive. So there's a life body that's keeping things going. And there's what he calls the astral body, or a consciousness body, that comes in when you wake up in the morning. You know, you're like a plant. You're a physical body that's alive on the bed. And then all of a sudden, my astral body has come in. I'm awake. I can look out. I'm conscious. And then I'm more, you could say, like an animal, which is also conscious and awake, and is awake. But then there's another element, which is the individual human ego. But he said, human beings are not complete. Sometimes when people say, well, what is anthroposophy? It's a philosophy that says that human beings are not complete. We're not done yet. We have to become human. We're in a process. And that ego has to work back on the rest of our constitution and transform it, permeate it, organize it, discipline it, educate it. So that's our work, is to take that human individuality and become human all the way through and through. It's a great challenge. All right. Rudolf Steiner separated from the Theosophical Society and founded the Anthroposophical Society. And he had basically three huge impulses. One is art. He brought art wherever he brought knowledge. He said if it's spiritual knowledge, it has to come in an artistic way. Also, if you have spiritual, true spiritual knowledge, will always manifest itself in practical daily life in a helpful way. You could say that's science. And it, I can't take my scarf off, never mind. And then also that spiritual knowledge always permeates, illumines everything with the kind of religious, inner, devotional attitude. That's there's an intent for the good that permeates spiritual knowledge. Out of that, they built the Goetheanum, which is a wonderful building in Switzerland, which was the manifestation of spiritual science artistically in architecture. It took them 10 years to build it, and then it was burned to the ground through arson. I should have said that Rudolf Steiner had a lot of enemies. Could imagine. Catholic and Protestants. He was talking about a kind of Christianity that was a cosmic Christianity that didn't adhere to the dogmas. But also occult leaders and movements were not happy with the fact that he spoke openly about spiritual realities that previous to that had been held in small, closed circles. And so, it became too dangerous during the war for him to travel and speak. The Goetheanum burned. That was a tragedy. 6 months later, and I should say that when Rudolf Steiner had to decide how to respond to the burning of the Goetheanum, he chose to re-found the Anthroposophical Society, which had been very disappointing to him, the society, to re-found it and join it. Previous to that, it had been something which existed. He was the teacher, and the students formed a society. Now he joined it and became its leader. That's a huge sacrifice, and it had never, that occult teachers didn't do that. So that was, again, doing something very different, becoming a leader of his pupils and a brother, you could say, by joining them. 6 months after that refounding, we have the agriculture course. Rudolf Steiner was very aware that what he was going to bring was going to go against the bull of public opinion. And for that reason, they actually agreed at the end of the agriculture course to not talk about it until it had been put into practice and there was something on the ground to show for it, because otherwise it was going to sound so weird. Anyway, I don't think they held it back. So, now comes the precy of biodynamics. He gave a long preamble before he gave anything practical. He kept kind of apologizing, saying, this isn't going to seem like it's directly related to agriculture, but you'll see why, and, you know, soon. And it was all in order to make what he was going to say that was practical understandable. If you don't understand it, it's hard to work with it over a longer period of time. So we talked about cosmic influences, back to the large scale of things. That all these rhythms that we heard about this morning from Mary, that this is the world that plants live in. They live in this world of cosmic rhythms. And if we are going to care for plants, we have to be aware of those rhythms. And he spoke about those rhythms in a very rudimentary way. And he also talked about that there would need to be a science developed out of for this, that it was just he kind of just said, people need to set to work to discover this, and then he went on to other things. He talked about the polarity, a huge polarity in nature, and many things you slowly see line up in that polarity. So in the mineral world, silica and limestone are a polarity. Silica, quartz, does that ring a bell? Yeah. Clear, sharp, bright. Limestone, dense. Silica has to do it, more with element of warmth, limestone with water. You know, limestone, is when you heat it up, it gets greedy for water. It's permeable by water. Water just runs right off of silica. Quartz doesn't, they don't interact. And that in plants, silica has to do with the more fine elements of nutrition, and limestone has more to do with reproduction. The quick rhythms, and he talks about the planets that relate to each of those. And basically he says there's this huge polarity, and that what we're looking for is not even Stephen kind of 50-50, but a balance, a healthy balance. We're always looking to find how this polarity resolves itself in health. And we see some plants just reproduce themselves frequently, like weeds. And then you have other plants that take a longer time and that develop nutritive qualities. And those are the ones that are related more to the silica. He talked about questions of quality in plants. And he said those questions go beyond our normal frame of reference. So he talks about that you couldn't get, even then, 1924, you couldn't get potatoes anymore like the ones that he ate in his childhood. So imagine how different our potatoes are. And he attributed that to a deterioration of the soil, and that came about through a mechanistic view of nature and mineral fertilizers. So 1924, he's telling them, mineral fertilizers have to phase out. You're going to have find this nutritive quality. And, as we heard from Mary, we're going to have to change our view of nature. That also is affecting nature. And the first really big practical thing he said was that the farm has to strive for the ideal of being a self-contained entity, a self-contained individuality, he even goes so far as to say. So you would have to have the right number of animals so that their manure would provide the right amount and kind of fertility for the soil to grow the crops that would be on that farm. That requires just that idea. I've always been drawn to intelligent people. I think farmers who strive to achieve the ideal of the self-contained farm, they have to be really intelligent. This is not a simple thing to achieve. You have to really bring about such a subtle, all the time changing balance, what kind of animals, how much land to devote to this and that. It's a whole world, a challenge, to really develop a self-contained farm. And if you're doing that, you wouldn't dream of exploiting your own land. What kind of jerk would undermine their own fertility? It's the opposite of just using the land for the profit. You're trying to create a healthy organism that will be ongoing, that will have fertility for the future. In this farm, the soil, he likened to being the diaphragm, the middle. And he said the soil is the foundation of agriculture. So you think here I'm standing like this. If I were to be like what he described as a plant or the farm individuality, I will not do it. I would have to be standing on my head. If I were younger and more agile, maybe I would, but I'm not going to. But you have to imagine that the intelligence of this farm individuality is in the soil. That's where that nerve system of intelligence and sensitivity is. And what's going on in the air is metabolism. That's the growth part, but it's not, so it's an upside down human being, the farm and the plant. All right. He talks about we need to recognize cosmic and earthly forces in the plant if we want to understand the plant. That's so interesting. We have to start seeing the plant as a balance, as a relationship between earthly forces and cosmic forces. And he uses as the example the root. He said a carrot or a beet or a turnip, a single taproot, is a cosmic form. Whereas a branching root, like a plant or something, is earthly. Can you get that picture? The one is a cosmic form and the other is more earthly. So you begin, he gives you clues about the signatures of things, and then you have to start educating yourself to see these things. All right. He does a great thing. He gives the spiritual tasks of the chemical elements. And I'm going to bring you three of them. There's more, but he talks about carbon. We all know about carbon in agriculture, right? But he talks about the air and pollution and all this. He talks about carbon as the great sculptor. It's the part of the earthly substance that forms a picture of the spiritual reality. And I always picture that, so, you know, when you burn wood and what's left is the carbon structure, you see the form of the wood is left, the water's gone, you know, but there's the image, the structural image is there. And anyway, that's the one thing. And then you have oxygen, which brings life into the structure. And oxygen bears the etheric. I talked about the life body. So oxygen bears that. And nitrogen, and oxygen and nitrogen are the big things in the air that we breathe, right? Carries the oxygen to the carbon. So, and that carries the astral, the consciousness. It's hard to get on a first hearing, but it's easier to get when you think about breathing. So we have nitrogen and oxygen in the air. We breathe them in.